Hey Amy, how are you?
I'm well, Alex. How are you?
Good. Anyway, how's life for you and Cody and Vivi down there in God's country in Penrose, Colorado?
You know what? It's beautiful. It's spring. We get earlier, brighter mornings and more relaxing evenings. And I've just been really enjoying the extra sunshine and a little extra rain in May than we're used to, I think.
It's interesting how these sounds that come out of these through these vocal cords and out of these little orbs called faces that express things, but these sounds that come out and they're different for every language and culture, really do. It's like if there's anything that transmits our heart and our character from one person to another, it's these words. That's what we remember. And isn't it interesting that God made us to give us such power through these things called words, and you reference how they form us and how they dictate who we are. When if you were if I were to put you on the spot and say, what are is there a time when you realized your words having extreme power, either for good or for bad? Does anything pop into your head?
Yeah, actually, when I became a mother, I remember telling myself in the moments where you're actually thinking about how you're going to parent or how you're going to respond to your child. And one of the first things that I decided is that I never tell my daughter, I'm your mother. I never tell her that. Like sometimes our communication, sometimes words have power by being omitted. And sometimes they have power by being spoken. Whether they're a truth or a lie, they still hold sway in the formation of our lives. And we believe a lot of what we're told and what is spoken to us, whether they're for ill or good.
You didn't want to use your motherhood as a means to get her in line, per se.
I decided not to use that as a course correction. Have I said that to my daughter before? Yes, I have, but as like an everyday practice, like a do more being and less saying. I never went a day without being told I was loved by both my parents, which is just absolutely like one of the best things you can give to your kids. Because there's some people who don't ever hear that, or it's only
Yeah.
pulled out for super special occasions
Yeah.
and
We're talking about the power of our words, and specifically in the area of prayer and how that can happen. I want to open with a passage out of the book of James, which talks about the power of our words or our mouth from a negative standpoint. And then I want to contrast it with a second scripture and then invite you to comment on that. Not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. Anyone who is never at fault in what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. When we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they're steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and it is itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind, but no human being can tame the tongue. It's a restless evil full of deadly poison. With the tongue, we praise our Lord and Father, and with it, we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing, my brothers and sisters. This should not be so. Before I let you comment, I just want to say it's interesting how, in two places in this passage, the author links the steering of the entire body to this one part of the body. Jesus said something quite different than that. So the disciples fail to heal a kid with their mouths. And it's interesting how Jesus used his words to heal people. And they're like, how come we couldn't do it? And he replied, Matthew 17, 20, because you have so little faith. Truly, I tell you, if you have faith as small as mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. So we have two opposing sides of the usage of the tongue. One of them is a metaphor for setting the whole planet on fire and controlling everything our bodies do. The other one, bringing healing to a kid or causing an entire mountain to shift from one location to the other. Are both of these hyperbole? Is there truth to either of these?
Who of us have not prayed for someone who was dying to live, or someone who died to be alive again? I think that the metaphors are a really powerful thing. Now, yes, the rudder of the body is the tongue. And when I think of scriptures that talk about speaking and what we say and how that affects people, I always think of Luke 6:45, from the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. And if you want to know what someone's feeling, if you just listen to them talk, not put on a show or whatever, but if you can just kind of listen to how they talk to others, how they talk to you, how they talk about themselves, about others, it tells you a lot about their heart. And I think we do absolutely have the ability to tear down and destroy with words. And we have the ability to build up, bolster, support, and love with words.
I guess what we're asking is, A, can we change what's in the heart? Can we transform to be the kind of people who have faith or who are not constantly cursing the world around them? And if there's a link in James to steering ourselves through our mouth, can we change our own course to become a different kind of person internally simply by changing what we say?
Are you ready, Boots? Start walking.